2001, the year the Big Day Out made headlines.
There are a few people in trouble down the front.
It was the year UK sensations Coldplay first visited our shores. It was the year PJ Harvey enticed everyone's side of stage, and it was another big year for Aussie heroes Powderfinger. Queens the Stone Age and the Black Eyed Peas made their Big Day Out debuts, and Killing Heidi introduced dancers to their set. It was the year Rammstein set themselves on fire, and everyone was talking about Texan Group at the drive-in.
I have a microphone and you know you're a sheep.
2001 was also the year US rap metal band Limp Bizkit headlined, and tragedy struck the Big Day Out, changing the festival forever.
When Limp Bizkit play, it's just gonna go stupid.
Let's dance rather than beat the shit out of each other.
Yeah, that is a sick record, man. Like that whole breaking stuff and the nookie and that is, you're wicked.
The 2001 Big Day Out started in Auckland on January 19, and Channel V travelled with the entire tour once again. This year, the interview load was shared between Jabba and new faces Yumi Steins and James Matheson, who were fresh from the 2000 Channel V presenter search. Also working his first Big Day Out was Andrew G, who anchored the massive six-hour live broadcast from Sydney.
The first one I ever worked at was 2001. And let me tell you, that was a totally different experience.
I remember standing there in my boxer shorts and a T-shirt, because it was just so hot out of Homebush and there was no trees, it was all concrete. I had a spray bottle of water that I was spraying on my feet.
And my technique is, hey, how's that?
That's what I'm talking about.
See, that's right.
And I did something like 40 interviews in 6 hours.
I remember thinking, as I'm in a helicopter flying over the Gold Coast Big Day Out site to get do some piece to camera, that it's f***ing awesome. Look at this. It's unreal. And I remember thinking that all day, like, I'm in a band's trailer. Look at this. I'm getting thrown out of a band's trailer. Look at this.
The lineup, which was headlined by Limp Bizkit, also featured Powderfinger, Rammstein, PJ Harvey, UMI, Coldplay, Carl Cox, Placebo, Killing Heidi, At The Drive-In, Friends of Rom, Mudvayne, 28 Days, Queens of the Stone Age, and a little-known hip-hop trio called the Black Eyed Peas.
Yo, we on the radio, hit you with the rap style, hit you on the stereo.
Well, in 2001 too, Black Eyed Peas got busted in Auckland. I spent 3 hours with Apple, that's right. First time I met him, just this scared guy in a prison cell at the airport. Because again, he missed his plane. It's the problem when musicians miss their designated flight with the band. They're not too good on their own. So he had two joints in his pocket.
So you don't take pot to New Zealand? Like, they grow their own there, mate. You idiot. So, you know, that show wasn't going to go ahead. It did go ahead. And yeah, it was fun to talk to them because I was a fan. But again, that was one where I got a bit overcome with nerves. All my questions were shit. And they just kind of rapped on the rap man.
And they were this kind of flaky, rough-edged hip-hop, you know, dudes, you know, and now they're buffed. They make Justin Timberlake look cool. But that was funny. Those illegality kind of things are kind of funny. We never have any real, you know, massive issues. They're all ones you can laugh at.
And we out.
Backstage at the Auckland Big Day Out is actually, it's an athletics track, an asphalt athletics track. So what they did was they set up a running race, and the race was between Big Limp Bizkit security, who are these massive tattooed guys, and Will.i.am from the Black Eyed Peas. Will.i.am is an amazing dresser, and he had these kind of three-quarter leg knickerbockers, and he had this suit, and he just looked incredible. He took his shoes off, so he's in his socks, and these guys had a 50-meter running race with every band there. And to cut a long story short, Will.i.am kicked his ass, and it's kind of a good reference to probably what the Black Eyed Peas have done to Limp Bizkit ever since.
You can't presume that people don't change. And I think that I'm not citing this as an error, but I mean one of the most interesting ones I had is in 2001 was talking to Chris from Coldplay, now in the foyer of the hotel in Auckland. I actually stupidly said to them, I said, "Oh, we weren't going to put, because we're on 2 o'clock in the afternoon on the main stage, so we really agonised over putting it on, because at that point in time you've only got one single, and I was worried that, you know, if you only had one single, the audience might get bored and walk, because we had that problem with Manic Street Preachers, and because I was just in that role, and I was kind of sitting there and saying, and luckily you've got a second song now, because now you'll keep the audience and it'll be okay, but I was really worried it wasn't going to work. This is before the first show. And it's going, oh, okay, thanks, I think. And then Chris was going, thank you very much. I mean, we've never even been in a hotel this nice, let alone stay in one like this. And now they can buy one.
In mid-2000, UK group Coldplay broke onto the international music scene with their debut album, Parachutes, which spawned the singles Shiver and Yellow.
We hear that Brian Molko from the band Placebo has banned Yellow backstage. No Yellow to be seen in his area. Do you think this is a backlash to the success of your single?
Is that true?
It was all yellow.
Is that really true about Brian Molko?
Yes.
Is that really because of us, though?
Well, that's what I'm here to find out.
Ask him about that.
I will.
I like Placebo. You tell him I bought their record not 2 days ago. And it was cold yellow. I can't believe that.
Don't let it eat you up. It's going to ruin the Coldplay show. That's it.
I've heard from sources I can't reveal that there has been a ban on Yellow backstage.
This is true.
This is absolutely true, yeah.
And Coldplay were really upset. Chris was upset that maybe it was because of their single band.
No, it's just because of the colour.
So who are you looking forward to seeing on the big day out 2000?
I'm in love with PJ Harvey.
Hey, PJ. PJ. She's been awesome. Cool.
UK rock goddess PJ Harvey had all the artists scrambling to get to the top spot side of stage for her set. Just prior to the 2001 tour, the singer had released her Mercury award-winning album, Stories from the City, Stories from the Sea, which exposed her to a more mainstream audience.
PJ Harvey, I mean, what can you say, she's a goddess. Thank God she finally came, because every year was always a rumour she was going to come, and for whatever reason, she never got here. Then finally she got here, and it was worth the wait. She was amazing.
We were going to come in 95 and then couldn't at the last minute, but I have been wanting to come for the last 5 or 6 years and just haven't made it yet.
PJ Harvey comes out, plays a few songs, and then her band leaves. This is in daylight on her own at a festival in front of 50,000 people in a hot red sequins dress.
She was just strutting on stage, and she was just the ultimate fox.
No one can pull that off, really, without getting booed off stage or getting, you know, a Mount Franklin water bottle that's been tipped out and filled with someone's urine, which I've seen happen at festivals. Guys, use the toilet.
She had every guy in the audience by the balls.
Lick my legs of desire.
Lick my legs and I'm on fire. Lick my legs and I'm desire.
PJ Harvey played at that one as well, with the Queens of the Stone Age, which, you know, watching from afar, I thought that was the start and the formation of an amazing artistic friendship, like a collaboration.
Were you just watching PJ from the side?
Yeah, I was just watching PJ. Yeah, me like PJ.
And you can always tell how other musicians, how in awe other musicians or in respect are when you sit on the side of stage and you can see all the musicians, and PJ Harvey pulled lots of musicians.
In 10 years, PJ Harvey was probably the classiest person I've ever interviewed at the Big Day Out. The fact that we turn up, we're interviewing her, and I say, can you wear this hat so that you look like Fred Durst? And she goes, who's Fred Durst?
You hope what?
I hope Fred Durst feels the same way.
Who's Fred Durst?
That kind of summed up the whole Big Day Out experience for me. You know, you live in the world where you think Limp Bizkit, they're headlining the Big Day Out, everyone knows Fred Durst. Here's PJ Harvey, you know, a goddess of the rock and roll game. Who's Fred Durst? That just encapsulated the Big Day Out for me. That would have to be one of my favourite moments.
Can you find me the red hat? I'll tell you in a moment.
What's your red hat? What are you on about?
I'll tell you. It's just a distractional part of the interview. So you get thrown.
Are you going to wear a silly red hat?
Well, I was hoping you would. So we could, because we're testing everyone to see what they would look like as Fred Durst. Here comes the very special red hat right now.
No, I'm not putting it on until you tell me who Fred Durst is.
Fred Durst is the lead singer of Limp Bizkit. He's the guy that...
Oh, right.
Yeah, who are headlining the show. Could we see what you look like?
No. Nope.
No? On your hand? Maybe a hand puppet?
No. Nope.
On your knee?
No. Nope.
On the ground?
No. Nope.
Okay.
I'm not wearing that hat.
No, like Fred.
Making their first Big Day Out appearance in 2001 was German group Rammstein, who brought with them dildos, pyrotechnics, and a translator.
Any band that sets fire to themselves during the opening number is pretty good to photograph. A la Rammstein, you know. You walk on stage and you set yourself to fire. It's a photographer's dream. It's bloody great.
I don't know what to say about Rammstein. Hilarious. I think there's a proportion of the music-loving community who think that they're for real, and there's another bunch who just go, those guys are just hilarious. They're just camp German sort of performance art. They're not to be taken seriously. So I thought they were terrific.
A lot of people didn't get it. The English never get it. You know, oh, they're fascists. I'm going, no, they're funny.
Yeah, Rammstein, that was weird because I think it was, from memory, it's like this, you know, 60-year-old woman doing the translating. It was like their mum. So you're trying to talk about, you know, Butch Dick, let's talk about these songs about dildos and fireworks and, you know, hardcore industrial music. And this woman's interpreting, and it all just kind of came out like it was some tourism video. It's wrong.
Has there been a lot of danger at shows?
Früher, als wir noch in Deutschland Clubshows machten, da haben wir immer Benzin ins Publikum gekippt. Das hatten wir gestern vergessen.
When they were performing in Berlin some time ago, they always poured petrol into the audience. They forgot to do that last night.
Brisbane group Powderfinger were riding high on the success of their single My Happiness, which was voted the number one song in Triple J's Hottest 100 during the tour. Other Australian bands, The Avalanches and Killing Heidi, were also finding success at home, and making their big day out comeback was UMI, who last appeared at the event in 1997 and played the very first festival in 1992.
I think our show in 2001, whenever it was I remember very vividly as being great, particularly in Sydney. So sharp, I'm a
f***ing heavy heart. I remember seeing UMI 1 year and they were fantastic. And it's different when it's bands that you know, your friends. I mean, it still exists today in Australia. We still kind of have this attitude that, you know, oh, we couldn't be the biggest band in the world, you know, we're not good enough. And then gradually, little step by step, every year we're realising that we can be, and maybe we will be, and maybe we are, you know. So every time you see one of your friends' bands and you see them playing on the big stage of the big day out and kicking ass, it's really uplifting. It makes you feel like a fan again. It's like, that's my friend up there! That's my bloody friend up there, mate!
My highlight was definitely Frenzel Rom, which I think it was really their year. 2001 was a great year for Frenzel. They were on the main stage and they basically kicked the ass of everyone that followed that year. It was totally amazing, totally fantastic. Lindsay was wearing a Boy Scout uniform, I think, the whole tour.
We went to a jamboree a couple of weeks ago. I thought, you know, being Australia Day and all, I thought I'd better flaunt the fucking arsehole that Australians are by wearing a Scout uniform.
Still to come on BDO XV 2001, tragedy strikes at the big day out in Sydney.
What can we expect from your set tonight?
You could expect a couple love ballads, a couple Elton John covers.
Lighters in the air?
I'd like to see some lighters in the air. You can expect some frontal nudity.
Sweet.
And you can expect...
But you'll be rather smaller after you, if you're going to do
Elvis
what you...
Presley songs.
Nice one.
And pretty much just a bunch of whacking off.
At 9:15 p.m. on Australia Day 2001, the face of the big day out changed forever with the tragic death of 16-year-old music fan Jessica Mikulik in the opening minutes of Limp Bizkit's set at the Sydney Big Day Out. The incident made the front pages of the national newspapers, caused Limp Bizkit to cancel the rest of the tour, and sparked a search for blame that continued long after the event.
It was really hot, I remember that as well. And the crowd was berserk that day, really berserk. I think we even had to get people to calm down.
And I remember the tension was really, really weird. You could feel it getting really, really strange all day. And it was getting, you could see the crowd getting crankier and crankier, and it got really, really strange. And I'll never, ever, ever forget, from the back of the stage, I could see them when Limp Bizkit came on, and just 30,000 people just rose once, rose twice, and then it all moved forward to the stage. And I just looked at it and went, someone just got really, really hurt. It was, you could feel it in the air.
In Sydney, all bands on the main stage agreed to be filmed except for Limp Bizkit, who over the course of 11 meetings that day gave guarded permission to record only 5 songs. Channel V was inundated with requests for footage, all of which were declined. Since the incident and the court proceedings that followed, Channel V no longer has permission to broadcast the Limp Bizkit footage in this context.
Limp Bizkit, what a great band they are. Not. That was really weird, I think, just as a you know, working for Channel V, and there was so much hype about this band that I didn't really know much about until I started working here, and then went, right, well, you know, a lot of the viewers really like this band, so let's give them a chance. And a chance was given, and they were crap.
Well, is it the band's fault, is it the crowd's fault, or is it the organiser's fault?
It's definitely not the band's fault.
I disagree, actually. I think the band has to take some responsibility. If they get the crowd to that kind of level of behaviour, then I think a lot of the responsibility lies with them.
Well, I don't really think it's the organiser's fault. I reckon it's the own person's fault. You're taking your own risk by going there.
It wasn't Limp Bizkit's fault. Everyone's got to take responsibility for it.
I read that somewhere that Limp Bizkit wanted to put a barrier up the middle and the organisers wouldn't do it.
Limp Bizkit had a history of trouble at shows, with guitarist Wes Borland stating the band were almost kicked off the 1998 Ozfest tour after they incited the audience to break through the barricade. According to Limp Bizkit, they had requested a tea barricade but were denied by the promoters. The promoters later issued a statement stating the tea barricade had not been requested until after the Auckland show, where a number of people collapsed due to crowd surges. They also believe the tea barricade would not be effective for a double stage environment, as it creates massive pressure points, restricts flow, and blocks emergency access.
Worst moments of our life. That was, of course, that was a really weird domino, because we went from the Chili Peppers, thought, well, that worked great, and then Pearl Jam wanted to do it, and then we're in the middle of that, and then, you know, I got a call. I was over in San Francisco having a holiday, thinking we had a headliner sorted out, and Vivian, my business partner, was actually at Roskilde on stage watching the show, and I got a call in the morning kind of going, there's, you know, tragedy, you know, 9 dead. And we'd seen Limp Bizkit the year and a half before, and that was in Japan at the Fuji Festival, and that's what I was saying about people change. It was funny, you know. Fred came out on a shoulder security guard, went all the way to the front of house desk with 35,000 people in front of them, all the Japanese people all singing. We were laughing like crazy. Well, that'll be funny. But then what happened in the meantime, we'd been caught off guard, like I think most people have been caught off guard. The rise and dominance of the internet accessed too many young boys to porn, and they became the figurehead of turning, as far as I'm concerned, turning girls into meat to a certain extent, you know, and don't care about each other. And on one hand, that's kind of like, well, kids are smarter and all that kind of stuff with it, but we all made lots of mistakes. And I'll have to carry that, you know, Jessica's death in Sydney, which is the fifth anniversary of it this year, is that that's something we'd never, ever, you know, accept as a reasonable, you know, casualty of, even if now it's 2.5 million people through. I mean, the statistics are unbelievably low considering the number of people we've got through. But it was the point where we didn't have a oneness with the audience.
When the band cancelled their remaining dates and returned home, fans were divided, with many anti-Limp Bizkit sentiments on display.
And I think they've really, really made an enemy of this country by disrespecting us and disrespecting our young people. Are you disappointed that Limp Bizkit aren't playing?
We are. We spent $500 because we live in Tassie.
Limp Bizkit can suck my limp dick.
Oh, I'm bitterly disappointed that they're not coming.
We waited for ages for them to come to Australia and they just pissed off.
And Limp Bizkit were just wankers about the whole thing. They took no responsibility whatsoever, and so we were asked to kind of take their spot, which we were glad to do. But it just kind of summed up, I think, the difference between what the Australian music industry is like and probably what the American industry is like. And you can't kind of take a broad brush to the whole American industry, but I think the metal side of it is just so egocentric. Somebody died at one of their shows, and their response was to leave the country. Lame.
I think one of the proudest moments that I had was being a part of the... she'd passed away on the 29th of January, and on the next show, we organised for a minute's silence at the Adelaide Big Day Out, and Powderfinger were on stage, and they handled it beautifully.
Ken and Viv, who run the Big Day Out, asked us to kind of dedicate a minute of silence or whatever to Jessica, because she died that morning. And it was pretty amazing, actually, because
We were kind of halfway through our set and we sort of said to the crowd, okay, look, the whole big day out's going to stop now and have a minute's silence, so can everyone just take it easy? And everyone did, you know, except for maybe one dickhead yelled something out or something, but to have that many people in complete silence was pretty amazing. And then played These Days after it, and people were still really quiet, and it's a pretty powerful moment, actually. These days turned out nothing like I had planned. They've obviously made lots of changes, and it's as safe as it can be for, like I said, 50,000 people in one place at one time. There's always going to be danger in that.
Or I try to distinctly convince people logically that you're a shareholder in a one-day company. You know, you buy a ticket, you're there. If you don't buy the ticket, it's not there, and so it's yours. You know, it's yours to make or break.
A lot of the time, from my point of view, looking down, it's quite difficult to, or for anyone, it's quite difficult to actually pinpoint who is in trouble and who's not, and that's where a lot of the responsibility has to come back onto the crowd and to the people at the show.
Next on BDO XV 2001, at the drive-in, Steal the Show and Yumi's Heart. With no Limp Bizkit on the tour, refunds are offered to ticket holders, though few take up the offer. All the bands are affected and the crowds respond to their pleas for safety and respectful behaviour. Ironically, the one band everyone talks about, Texan punk group At The Drive-In, walk off stage only 15 minutes into their Sydney show after the crowd refuses to heed warnings to stop moshing.
I think it's a very, very sad day when the only way you can express yourself is through slam dancing. Are you all typically white people?
At The Drive-In, took the stage, so many people packed in to try and see them. And I mean, really, it's not 1994, nobody crowd surfs anymore, and getting a Doc Martin in the head is just no fun. And you know, you can dance without stepping on girls, and at the drive-in we're on stage, and they asked the crowd a couple of times, relax, don't do that, and then eventually they just said, look, we're not gonna have this. Here's a band at the peak of their acceptance and their popularity in Australia. They just walked off stage. It was a great moment.
At the drive-in really cemented the idea that a band is at least partially responsible for their audience, which is obvious, I think, to most respectable people. But it's just so ironic that later that day, Limp Bizkit had to take the stage and just say, let's fuck shit up, which is really irresponsible.
At the drive-in in Melbourne did a similar situation. Everybody listened to every word. And when they said, stop using girls as stools, I thought it was particularly appropriate. At the time, and then the audience went, okay, fine.
Yeah.
So I think even in such a short term, you know, 48 hours, the change of events were happening pretty quick in terms of the psyche of the audience.
We're going to ask you tonight if you guys could just be quiet for a minute and think about her and keep her soul in your head. If you just have a moment of silence for somebody that was injured.
I want to go see At The Drive-In.
At The Drive-In's what we found.
We're going to go watch At The Drive-In, I think you'll find.
They were the best band of the day.
They kind of run along the whole vibe that we all should be running along, so yeah, they're awesome.
No, we just play. I mean, we don't believe that. We just, you know, keep our heads small. It's a better thing to do, you know?
It's not our main focus in life, is to be the best, you know, tightest. Like, go see NSYNC if you want to see perfect, you know? Like, if you want to see rock and roll, come see a rock and roll band. It's not about perfection, it's about heart and soul.
Seemingly at the peak of their popularity, At The Drive-In also visit the Channel V No. 2 studio to perform a blistering live set on The Joint.
Last night on The Joint was just bloody great.
It was fun.
It was fun because it was totally different, because we've never played TV shows without an audience. So to actually give us a chance to just kick back and do something different.
And I remember I always used to see Omar walking around backstage. He was videoing everything on his little handycam video, and I just thought, maybe we'll meet and fall in love. And I was too shy to meet him and fall in love with him. Well, I did fall in love with him a little bit, but I was too shy to actually have a conversation with him. And I remember this is at the Melbourne Big Day Out. He came up to me to start talking to me, and I got so scared, I turned around and wait!
The 2001 Big Day Out finished up in Perth on the 4th of February, with many wondering whether the festival would return in 2002. Although the festival was marred with tragedy and controversy, more than 215,000 people still attended the event.
The mood totally changed when Limp Bizkit went. Ticket sales actually went up in Adelaide and Perth because a lot of people weren't going to the show because of them, which was kind of weird. And the cloud kind of went, apart from, of course, you know, internally our team were dealing with a horrendous situation that the media were not only having to deal with the obvious realities of dealing with Jessica's family and trying to deal with all of that, but to the media were out for, if anything goes wrong, it'll be front page. So it was really, you know, very, very scary.
In 2001, after we'd had a very difficult year in Perth, I was standing side of stage while PJ Harvey played, and she actually dedicated a song to me and said, just a beautiful, and it was spontaneous and beautiful, and I wasn't expecting it. But it was that moment that she actually took to say thank you, and her acceptance that we were going through a really difficult time and acknowledging that and kind of giving a bit of tribute.
G'day. Saturday the 4th of February, the day before the Perth Big Day Out. We are in a park just next to the Swan River here in Perth. And what's going on behind me is apparently quite a tradition. It's the Powderfinger v the rest of the world cricket team.
Everyone was, you know, having a hard time on the tour. And so when Bernard Fenning put the call out saying, let's play cricket, it was amazing. And it was Coldplay, the Go-Betweens, Powderfinger. It was basically Australia versus the rest of the world. Our executive producer, Ben Richardson, was the umpire. And it was a great way to kind of let off some weird tension that was happening on the tour.
Next time on BDO XV, the Big Day Out returns in 2002 with Garbage, New Order, Jurassic 5 and Silverchair.
One more beat. Gates open. Step 2.